بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا ماكثين فيه أبدا وينذر الذين قالوا اتخذ الله ولدا ما لهم به من علم ولا لآبائهم كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا فلعلك باخع نفسك على آثارهم إن لم يؤمنوا بهذا الحديث أسفا إنا جعلنا ما على الأرض زينة لها لنبلوهم أيهم أحسن عملا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا ماكثين فيه أبدا وينذر الذين قالوا اتخذ الله ولدا ما لهم به من علم ولا لآبائهم كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا فلعلك باخع نفسك على آثارهم إن لم يؤمنوا بهذا الحديث أسفا إنا جعلنا ما على الأرض زينة لها لنبلوهم أيهم أحسن عملا وإنا لجاعلون ما عليها صعيدا جرزا أم حسبت أن أصحاب الكهف والرقيم كانوا من آياتنا عجبا إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا صدق الله العظيم. We've mentioned last week when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause the mountains to be removed and the earth will be flattened and it will be a leveled plain. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect each and every person in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah and Allah ta'ala will not spare anybody. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then present each and everyone and call each and everyone in rows in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell us لَقَدْ جِئْتُمُونَا فُرَادَا كَمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةِ. You have indeed returned back to me by yourself singly without anybody with you in the same manner that we've created you in the first time, whilst you have thought that we would not give you an appointment, and you thought that we forgot about you, and we thought that you are not going to meet us. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls us and we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will present us with our book of good deeds, our book of bad deeds. And then those who did evil and those the wrongdoers, they will be fearful and they will have so much regret and remorse, and they will say how we wish that our book were never ever given to us. This book does not contain a small or a big, be it good or bad, except that it's within this book, that it's mentioned within this book. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says they will find whatever they did present in front of them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not harm, neither does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala oppress any of His creation. وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then mentions in the 50th verse of Surah Al-Kahf, and once again keeping in mind that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets examples in the dunya of the present, the past, and in the akhirah of the future that is to happen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala set an example of a person who possessed two gardens, and what his outcome was of his heedlessness and him forgetting about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how his entire story unfolded in him at the end of the day being so regretful that he says, Ya laytani lam ushrik bi rabbi ahada, how I wish I have not associated any partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala moves on to speak about the hayat dunya, the life on this world. What is the life on this world like? What is it, this life on this world? A part of this, this thing that we see every day, a part of me waking up and going to work and coming back from work. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets a beautiful parable of what the true essence of the life on this dunya really is about. An example that many, many of us, we see in front of us, but we don't see it. We love it, but we don't feel it. We hear about it, but we do not absorb what we hear. It does not penetrate our heart, and we don't see the dunya with that insight of the basira, that insight that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us within our hearts, that we are able to differentiate and distinguish between what is good and what is bad, and what is really a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But instead, we just look with our eyes in the same manner that the believer and the disbeliever sees with his eyes. He sees the external factors, he sees the materialistic factors, and in the same manner that the animals also see with their eyes, they just see beyond them, but they cannot. Their eyes does not translate what they see into signs from Allah that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's just an object, it's just this, it's just that, but I do not translate it as a sign. And a part of not translating it into a sign, if I do not translate it into a sign, I cannot be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because I do not return and revert that very blessing of mine, or that trial of mine that I am placed in, or that situation, or that condition of mine that I'm placed in, I do not revert it back to Allah. So if I cannot revert it back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because I do not acknowledge that it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how can I be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So, وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, and give an example of the hayat al-dunya, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the hayat al-dunya. And after the life on this dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, within this life on this dunya, this is the dunya, the life, your worldly life, but within this worldly life, we have also placed certain things which are signs indicating to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which are there for you to use, for you to benefit from, but which is really a vehicle for you to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-mal wal-banuna zinatul hayati dunya. So the wealth, your wealth and your children, it's the beauty and the frills and the adornments of this dunya. But remember, وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتُ خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرٌ أَمَلًا. But that good deeds that are everlasting, that are perpetual in its reward, it's best in terms of its reward by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's best in terms of its hope for the person who hopes and desires Allah, the satisfaction of Allah, the companionship of Rasulullah, and the Jannah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared. May Allah grant us that. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then mentions, after moving from the history, moving to the present, Allah ta'ala moves into the future. Then Allah ta'ala speaks about the day of Qiyamah and what the day of Qiyamah is like. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then takes us back to a story that reiterates itself إنه لقرآن. Similar sequences, similar formats, slightly different words, but each and every time it's mentioned, there's a lesson in it for us. A lesson that in the one that the other one does not advocate. A new lesson, a new wisdom that we have been accustomed to, as we've been accustomed to in the past few weeks, that each and every word and each and every sentence and each and every ayah contains wisdoms. Whilst we are not able to comprehend each and every wisdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed within the ayahs, we can but with our limited intellect, we can ponder like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has instructed us to ponder, and through the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and through the pourings that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up your heart to understand certain things from the verse that you can use as a ship that will take you across the ocean of the dunya into the akhirah. But remember and be rest assured that whatever you are able to understand and whatever I am able to understand, it is but the key to understanding and to unlocking the true jewels that is contained within the Quran. So no matter how much we expound, irrespective of how much we explain and grammatically and from a historical background and from a fiqh background and from a miraculous background, whatever that contains and whatever explanations go with it, remember that this ayahs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has presented us with, this beautiful book of the Quran, whenever you read it, you will be, with pondering and with thinking, you will be able to extract the wisdoms and lessons from it that will be beneficial for you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a verse that sometimes we read across and we read very swiftly across it without paying much attention to it because you hear it very often in the Quran. The scenario that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sketches is very similar to the other scenarios. Allah ta'ala says that Allah ta'ala instructs the malaika to make sujood for Nabi Adam. They make sujood. The one who rejects is who? Iblis rejects to make sujood. And Allah ta'ala says, why do you not want to make sujood? He says, I'm better than him. You've created me from clay and you've created him from clay and me from fire. And Allah ta'ala says, ukhruj minha, step out of the Jannah and your curse is upon me. And this is the very same scenario that repeats itself in slightly different wording at times. But let's pause for a few moments. Let's analyze this verse. Let's try and join the other verses that also speaks about the very same story. And let's see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in this verse. And what is the significance for us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us about the story that happened in the past, that we Iblis refused to make sujood for Adam? How does it relate to me? What does it benefit me in this day? Remember, each and every verse of Allah ta'ala is practical. Practical examples, practical life advices. How does this relate to us? Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ فَفَسَقَ عَنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّهِ أَفَتَتَّخِذُونَهُ وَذُرِّيَّتَهُ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِنْ دُونِي وَهُمْ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌّ بِئْسَ لِلظَّالِمِينَ بَدَلًا. صدق الله العظيم. الله سبحانه وتعالى says, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا, and when we said, لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ to the angels, أُسْجُدُوا, prostrate, لِآدَم, prostrate to Adam. فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا Iblis. فَسَجَدُوا, they prostrated, إِلَّا, except, save Iblis. كا, Kana min al jinn. Kana, he was, min, from, amongst. Al jinn is the jinn. So, save except Iblis. Kana min al jinn, he was amongst the jinn, or he was from the jinn species. Fafasaqa an amri rabbihi. Fasaqa is to disobey, to transgress. An, from, amri, the instructions, the commandments, the orders, rabbihi, his lord. Kana min al jinn, he was from amongst the jinn species. Fafasaqa an amri rabbihi, he transgressed and he trespassed the instructions and the commandments of his lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Afatattakhidhunahu, do you take him, do you regard him, wa dhurriyatahu, and his offspring, awliya, as friends, wa hum lakum adu, wa hum, whilst they are an enemy to you, wahum, and they, lakum, to you, adu is enemy, whilst they are an enemy to you, bi'sa lidhalimeena badala. Bi'sa is evil, dhalimeen is wrongdoers, oppressors, and badala is an exchange. So an evil exchange is it for the wrongdoers. This is the literal translation of the ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, firstly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us of a very, very important quality and characteristic and attribute that is found within a person that has the possibility to completely destroy that person. To completely destroy that person. This attribute, if it's found within the person and he does not pay attention to it, he does not try and cure himself from this illness, this disease, it can become fatal. Wal'iyadhu billah. This disease is known as the disease of kibr. Kibr is boastfulness. Pride, boastfulness, and pride, snobbishness. And this attribute and this characteristic is one that is extremely fine. It's daqiq, it is fine to trace in the person, that even the person at times, perhaps he won't be able to trace it. But this disease is known as a shirk al-asghar, the minor shirk, bil-ayyadu billah. So the greater shirk is when you associate openly partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is what is known to us and what is apparent. The minor shirk, a shirkul khafi, or the hidden and the concealed shirk, is kibr. So what is kibr? Kibr is, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال ذرة من كبر. A person who has a grain of kibr within his heart cannot enter Jannah. So the companion said, Ya Rasulullah, and this hadith comes in Muslim, Ya Rasulullah, but you know, we wear sometimes new clothes and we have new things and we feel happy about it. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, no, that is not kibr. Inna Allah jameelun yuhibbul jamal. Distinguish, differentiate. Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty. So having nice clothes and having a beautiful vehicle, have a beautiful house, mashallah, that is beauty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted you. Amma bi ni'mati rabbika fahaddith, when Allah ta'ala has placed you in a position of comfort and blessing and bliss, then indicate and show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's favors upon you. And then allow that to be a means of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without being musrif, without israf, without wasting, jazakum, without wasting. But then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continues to say that al-kibru batru al-haqqi wa ghamtu an-nas. The definition of kibr, the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam defined it, is batru al-haqq, بطر الحق is to reject the truth وغمط الناس and to degrade and undermine people. That is كبر. So when you are faced in a situation where the truth is contrary to what I think, I'm going to reject it merely because it's contrary to what I think, or contrary to what I feel, or contrary to my lifestyle. وغمط الناس, and whoever is not in your bracket, whoever does not think like you, whoever does not look like you, whoever does not weigh like you, whoever does not move in your circles, you undermine that person and you degrade that person. So that is kibr. So batar al-haq, to reject the truth. An example is, I have a discussion with someone, and I use this because this is a very prevalent example. Hatta our teachers used to tell us that even the ulama are afflicted with this. Even the ulama, perhaps even more in the ulama. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned this in a hadith, that one of the first people that is going to enter the fire of Jahannam is going to be a alim. It's going to be a alim. Going to enter the fire of Jahannam. أول من تسعر بهم النار ثلاثة. Three people. A alim, a rich person, and a qari, a reciter of the Quran. First three. You would regard these three people as the most advantageous people in terms of the condition on this dunya, by virtue of the knowledge, by virtue of the beautiful recitations, and by virtue of the wealth that they're spending in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In another narration, it is a mujahid, a person who fights in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by virtue of his bravery and him giving everything for the deen. But there was one element that was present that caused the destruction, and that was the kibr. It was the kibr, ash-shirk al-khafi, the minor and the hidden and concealed shirk was present within their heart that they were not able to trace and rid their heart from, and as a result of that, it was fatal and it caused destruction in the akhir. So the alim, you've learned knowledge, so people can say, diman is khaliyat, diman kin, and he had fatwas and his knowledge, and it's so veel boeken gelees. People said so. There's no place for you in the Jannah. Go and enter Jahannam. A ghani, a rich person, is wealthy, and people acknowledge and attribute wealth to him, but in the same breath, they attributed generosity to him. He's a generous, wealthy person. If you need anything, go to that person, he'll give you. So the person used to give, and people used to speak about it, and he used to give, and he made it known that, you know, he is the person that gives. So yes, you've been giving, but you haven't been giving for me. You didn't give for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You gave liyuqal annaka 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 annaka. So it may be said on the day of Qiyamah, you are, you are, you, you. It may be said on the dunya that you are, you are, you are, you are. وَقَدْ قِيل, and it had been said. Take him away. The mujahid, you fought so the people can say you are brave, and it has been said, there's no place for you in Jannah. So this disease of kibr, it comes in the Ihya Ulumuddin of Imam Ghazali. The book is translated as The Revival of the Science of Deen. This ailment or this disease, it comes in the book of Imam Ghazali under the chapter of Al-Muhlikat. Rub' Al-Muhlikat is the quarter of destruction. The quarter, he's divided his book into quarters. So this quarter in the book that he speaks about kibr, the heading of that quarter is called Rub' al-Muhlikat, is a chapter that deals with issues of destruction. That is how fatal it is, it's how dangerous it is, that it can cause a destruction. May Allah Ta'ala save us. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says, tell the Malaika, usjudu li Adam. Remember, this is after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Nabi Adam. So let's go a step back. Earlier or prior to this dialogue that happens between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the malaika. Allah ta'ala says, previously when Allah ta'ala had spoken to the malaika, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a dialogue with him and said, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. So there's a Khalifa that I'll be putting on earth. So the Malaika responded, and we know what the Malaika said, you're going to place someone on the earth, and they're going to create facade and corruption, and they're going to shed blood, and we are worshipping you, Allah. So Allah Ta'ala says, I know what you know not. Now, what the Malaika refers to here is prior to the coming of human beings to this dunya, there was a species of jinn that lived on this dunya, according to the majority of the ulama. And they derive from this, from that ayah, they derive that evidence as well, that prior to the life of Bani Adam means that Bani is the children, and Adam means Adam alayhi salam. So when we say Bani Adam, it means the sons of Adam, or the children of Adam, or the progeny of Adam. So prior to the living and the habitation of Bani Adam on this earth, there was jinn. And then Allah Ta'ala tells the Malaika, I know what you know not. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala created Nabi Adam alayhi salam. And when Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala creates Nabi Adam, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala then breathes into Nabi Adam with Allah Subhanahu with the soul, his soul, and he becomes a living person. And then Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala then instructs the Malaika, and Allah Ta'ala tells the Malaika, tell me the names of these things. What is this called? What's it? What's it? What's it? The Malaika say, لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. Oh Allah, we have no knowledge except that which you taught us, ya Allah. And you have not taught us the knowledge of these things, therefore we cannot tell you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Nabi Adam alayhi salam, ya Adam, أنبئهم بأسمائي. Oh Adam, inform them what the names of these things are. So Nabi Adam starts saying the names of the things. He starts naming each and everything in the manner that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had taught him, in the manner that Allah Ta'ala has revealed unto him. And then Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala then responds after Nabi Adam mentions all these things names. Then Allah Ta'ala says, Alam aqul lakum inni a'lamu ghayba as-samawati wal ard wa a'lamu ma tubduna wa ma kuntum taktumun. Did I not tell you that I know the knowledge of the unseen, and what you know is little in comparison to my knowledge? So the Malaika submits. They acknowledge that Nabi Adam is a special creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, now that you have realized how special this creation of mine is, this human being, prostrate for him. أُسْجُدُوا لِآدَمْ. So now we're putting things, we're putting the entire story into context now. We understand how it came about, and now we reaching the stage where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs the Malaika now. Oh my Malaika, you are my sinless creation that never disobey me, that always follow my instructions and my commands, that do nothing else but worship me and obey my orders. But I want you to prostrate to this imperfect human being that I've created. Not referring to Nabi Adam alayhi salam, but referring to a general human being. We know that the Anbiya alayhim salam are ma'asumeen, they are infallible. So, what is the Malaika's response? What is the Malaika's response? You need to appreciate, here is creations that have been serving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for years and thousands, and Allah ta'ala alone knows for how long they've been serving and worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here all of a sudden Allah ta'ala creates a human being, one of the creation of Allah, and creation that they've been serving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala since many, many years. Allah ta'ala tells me now prostrate for this human being. Allah, but we prostrate to you. How can you tell us to prostrate for? We've seen how you created this human being. We've seen what you've used, the components, the ingredients that you've used to put together and to form this human being. This is, our form is much superior than this formation. What is their response? Fasajadu, without a question, without a second of doubt and hesitation, they immediately fall into prostration, showing their obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's orders. Now let's give a life example. If you were to work in a company, if you were to work in a company, and you've been working in that company for 10, 15, 20 years, and mashallah, you've managed to start off at a certain position and you're gradually working yourself up to a certain position. And here you see, all of a sudden, here someone is recruited, has perhaps less experience than you, is not as competent as you, but all of a sudden he excels and he goes beyond you. How? What is your feeling? The boss tells you that I am going to make him your manager. I'm going to make him your supervisor or you, your senior. Whilst you know that this person is incapable of performing the duties that you are able to perform. He, in terms of his experience, is less. In terms of his age, perhaps he's less. In terms of his makeup and his knowledge, he's much less than you. How would you feel? This is not right. But that was not the response of the malaika. The response of the malaika is when Allah Ta'ala says, "Usjudu li Adam." There was no hesitation. Immediately they fell into prostration. For them it was not who they performing prostration to. To them it was not who they are making sujood to. To them they regarded who the instruction came from. So it was not important who I'm making sujood to. What is important here is Allah Ta'ala instructed me and that was enough. That is on the one side. So now let's take the counterpart. فَسَجَدُوا. What happened? إِلَّا Iblis. Now the malaika performing sujood, except one creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is standing. All the malaika making sujood. Allah ta'ala says, "Ya Iblis, مَا لَكَ أَلَّا تَكُونَ مَعَ السَّاجِدِينَ." Did you not hear my order? Did you not hear my command? Did you not hear my instruction? Why are you not performing sujood like they are performing? So he says, "لَمْ أَكُنْ لِأَسْجُدَ لِبَشَرٍ خَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ صَلْصَالٍ مِنْ حَمَئٍ مَسْنُونٍ." So this Iblis, before we get to that, Iblis was, it is a established fact that he was from the jinn. And the evidence for that is, Allah Ta'ala says, "Ya in the verse, إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ." So now there's a discussion amongst the ulama whether Iblis was from the malaika or whether he was from the jinn. So this verse clearly stipulates that Iblis was from the jinn and that the malaika was of a different species. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Illa Iblis," and Allah ta'ala stopped, it would mean that Iblis could have possibly been part of the malaika. But Allah ta'ala excluded him by saying, "Kana min al-jinn," he was from the jinn. Whereas the malaika were not from the jinn. كان من الجن ففسق عن أمر ربه. So he transgressed and he disobeyed the order and the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We pause. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the verse here does not now take the dialogue beyond this. Here Allah ta'ala stops and Allah ta'ala moves along. But in other verses, Allah ta'ala mentions the entire dialogue that takes place between Iblis and between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the malaika currently in sujood, Allah Ta'ala is telling Iblis, "مَا لَكَ أَلَّا تَكُونَ مَعَ السَّاجِدِينَ." Why are you not performing sujood? So he says, "لَمْ أَكُنْ لِأَسْجُدَ لِبَشَرٍ خَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ صَلْصَالٍ مِنْ حَمَئٍ مَسْنُونَ." How? He tells Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, "I am not to perform sujood and to prostrate for a person or a human being that you've created from clay." Here Iblis does not see the instruction coming from Allah. Yeah, Iblis is looking at what he is performing sujood. So he disregards the order that is coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he's now more focused on what he is performing sujood to. Or what he's performing sujood at. And this is an important lesson because in our life, many a times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says things. Allah ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says things. But because it comes from a certain individual, that don't necessarily see eye to eye, or I'm not in the best understanding of that person, I'm not going to take his advice. Because I'm looking at the individual, and I'm not looking at from who the advice and the instructions are coming from. I'm willing to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because it's come from a person. And this was the same theory that Iblis applied. So that is another Iblisiyah. That is an Iblis theory. And every time you are faced with it, and you see an instruction coming from someone, and that person perhaps is not in the best terms with you, but it's what Allah Ta'ala says and what Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, remind yourself and says, and tell yourself, I'm not going to approach this in the same manner that Iblis approached it, but my approach is going to be the approach of the Malaika. I look at the instruction, regardless of who gives the instruction. If it comes from Allah, clear-cut evidence from Allah, authentic ahadith from Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, irrespective if it's my enemy, I'm going to implement it. That is the theory of the Malaika. So Iblis says, I am not to perform sujood to someone that you created from clay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, why do you not perform sujood? So he says, أنا خير منه. Oh Allah, do you not know I'm better than him? Now just see how the kibr starts displaying itself. The kibr starts displaying itself, and this is why it's known as the shirkul khafi, because it is not apparent, it's not apparent, it's not apparent, it's not apparent, it's not apparent, and all of a sudden when the person is placed under a certain condition, under a certain situation, then the person starts taking his ammunition out. He starts taking his guns out, and now he starts displaying his true characters and his true colors. All the time, he was worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was making sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until it was said that the narration that narrates the least amount of years that Iblis worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the least narration is 7,000 years. That is the narration that narrates the least amount of years that Iblis had worshipped Allah. 7,000 years worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making sujood for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed him in charge of certain affairs in the sama'ud dunya, and started entering into his heart. He started, kibr started infiltrating. He thought he had position, he had ranks, he had stations. And when Allah ta'ala created this new creation, he said, no. Ana khayrun minhu. Oh Allah, the very least is give me credit for my makeup. Give me credit for my formation. You know what I made, my makeup. My composition is much more superior than his. I am made from fire and he is made from clay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, فَخْرُجْ مِنْهَا فَإِنَّكَ رَجِيمٌ. Allah ta'ala tells him, Iblis, you've worshipped me for so many thousand years, but you've missed the whole idea of worshipping me. You've missed it. You've missed it. And as a result of it, it led you to disobey me openly, outrightly, in front of all of my creation. You rejected my instructions. And instead, you challenged me. فَخْرُجْ مِنْهَا فَإِنَّكَ رَجِيمٌ. Leave and you are rejected and you are cursed. وَإِنَّ عَلَيْكَ اللَّعْنَةَ إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ. Allah Ta'ala says, and upon you shall be my curse until the day of judgment. As Iblis leaves, he turns around and he says, Ya Allah, Rabbi, look at how the amount of kibr that has entered his heart, that he is not only disobeying the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but now he openly challenges Allah. Now he says, Rabbi, fa'anzirni ila yawmi yub'athun. He says, Oh Allah, give me respite. Give me time until the day of resurrection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, he shows mercy to him and he says, فَإِنَّكَ مِنَ الْمُنْظَرِينَ. It's fine. I will give you respite. I will give you respite. Take your time until the day of resurrection and then I'll deal with you as I deal with all of my creation. So he says, رَبِّي فَبِمَا أَغْوَيْتَنِي. Oh Allah, you've made a promise, now you're going to give me respite. For what you have placed me in, and for your curse upon me, لَأُزَيِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. He says, I am going to beautify all evil to them, and I'm going to mislead all of them. In another verse, لَأَقْعُدَنَّ لَهُمْ صِرَاطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. I'm going to sit on the Sirat al-Mustaqim. on the straight path. ثُمَّ لَآتِيَنَّهُمْ And when they walking on the sirat al-mustaqim, لَآتِيَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ وَعَنْ إِمَانِهِمْ وَعَنْ شَمَائِلِهِمْ I'm going to appear in front of them. I'm going to appear from behind them. If it's not going to work, I'm going to go on the right. And then I'm going to go on the left. An indication that I am not going to leave them. Wherever they go, I'm going to go. And after I'm done with them, لَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرَهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ You will find most of them are not going to be thankful and grateful to you, Allah. After I'm done with him, لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ I'm going to mislead all of them. Then he says, إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ Except your servants who are sincere and truthful to you. I won't be able to mislead. اللهم جعلنا منهم. May Allah Ta'ala make us of them. Ameen Ya Rabbal Alameen. So Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala responds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, Iblis, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانٌ إِلَّا مَنِ اتَّبَعَكَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ Iblis, know that those are my slaves and I will not grant you authority over them except and save those who are going to follow you. But whoever is not going to follow you, they are my slaves and I'm not going to grant you authority over them. And those who follow you, إِنَّ جَهَنَّمَ لَمَوْعِدُهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ The abode and the final promise that I've given them is the promise that I'm giving you that Jahannam is going to be your abode. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then ends the dialogue with Iblis. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose and elected Nabi Adam alayhi salam to be a superior being of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from that time, Allah ta'ala elects. And until the day of Qiyamah, Allah ta'ala will choose and Allah ta'ala will elect servants. It will be superior and it will be better than others. And that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants some people that Allah ta'ala sees that they have a potential that will be that have potential to be guides to others. So Allah Ta'ala elected from all of His creation, Allah Ta'ala elected human beings. Allah Ta'ala elected from the human beings, Allah Ta'ala chose the malaik, the anbiya and the rusul and the sahaba, ridwanullah ta'ala alayhim ajma'in and the sahaba. So if you, Iblis, if you dispute that he is special to me and why is he so special, then similarly, other people in other nations have also disputed why are certain people better and why are certain people special. So in the qissa of Talut, who knows the story of Talut? Talut was a person who was not too wealthy, but it was in a time when there was no prophet. In fact, it was in the time when there was a prophet, but then what in Bani Israel, but then what happened was they had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed from them a blessing, a tabut, which was a sense of tranquility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had gifted them with. Allah ta'ala took it away from them, and it was with the enemy. The enemy stole it from them, and as a result of that, they had bad luck and they had a difficult life after that. So they decided the only way we are going to regain our life and our enjoyment that we had is if we get back that tabut. And that tabut contains the sakina, the mercy, the tranquility of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as long as that is amongst them, this tranquility, this mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends upon them. But there's one problem. They don't have a king. So what happens is, they tell the prophet, you know, you are a prophet. It is not possible for a prophet to be a king because we don't want to mix politics with religion. So why does your Lord not give us a king and then we will go and fight these people so we can regain our tabut? So the prophet says, okay, I will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to elect a king amongst you, And when a king is elected, and then you have no alibi, and you have no excuse but to fight in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to regain what is lawfully yours. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs the Prophet of that time, and Allah ta'ala tells him that Talut is going to be the king. And the story comes in Surah Al-Baqarah. The end of the second juz. So when the Prophet goes to them and he tells him that Talut is your king, they say, but why him? قالوا أن يكون له الملك علينا ونحن أحق بالملك منه ولم يؤت سعة من المال. Why must he be the king? We are the wealthy. We are the affluent people in the community. Why must this poor person be our king? Why can we, not one of us, be the king? We have more wealth than him. So the Nabi responded and he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاهُ عَلَيْكُمْ. Allah Ta'ala has chosen him. So they rejected Talut as the king and they did not want to accept him. Eventually Talut, through the wisdom that Allah Ta'ala has granted him, he's placed him through certain trials and certain tribulations, and eventually only a small group of them managed to stay along his side, and it is through that small group that Allah Ta'ala granted him victory against Jalut. It's known as Goliath. When Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَمَّا بَرَزُوا لِجَالُوتَ وَجُنُودِهِ قَالُوا رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ فَهَزَمُوهُمْ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. That when they entered into the battle with Jalut and his army, they said, how are we going to win Jalut and his army? Look how big is his army and look how small is our army. All the people that were with us, they were filtered along the way with the different trials and different tribulations that Talut put them through, and they all fell through, and it's only us that is left. How are we going to win them? So those who had believed, they said, رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامًا وَصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And through that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted them victory. Nevertheless, not only in the qissa of Talut, perhaps in the time of the Yahud in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when they received clear instructions within their book that he is going to come a prophet and he is going to come at the end of time and you must obey him, they said, oh, we're waiting for the prophet to come, we're waiting for the prophet. And eventually when the prophet came sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he never came from the Jews and he came from the Arabs, and they rejected it. And they said, no, he cannot be a prophet. Although they saw all the signs, آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابَ يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. Those who have been given the book, referring to the Yahud, they know very well that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the messenger, because we've given them all the signs, and all the signs were prevalent on him that we've mentioned in their scripts. But they still rejected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam because he was not from the Yahud. Similarly, Iblis rejected, whilst he saw within Nabi Adam alayhi salam all the components of a Khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the instructions and the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and through his kibr, he still rejected it. So the karama and the honor for humanity is when a person submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's command. And when the person rejects the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he becomes worse than an animal. He becomes worse than an animal. On the day of Qiyamah, in fact, he is going to wish that he can be amongst the animals. Imagine this. On the day of Qiyamah, a person who rejects the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he's going to be worse than an animal in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is going to wish on the day of Qiyamah that he was an animal. How is that possible? Remember, on the day of Qiyamah, Allah ta'ala will resurrect all his creation, and including the creation that Allah will resurrect is going to be the animals. So the animals are not going to enter Jannah, except a few animals which is mentioned. So all the other animals will not enter Jannah. What will happen? Allah Ta'ala will bring them all in front of Allah. And then, فَيَقْتَصُ بَعْضُهُمْ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. The one will take his rights from the other one. And when each and everyone took their rights from one another, and they are equal now, then Allah Ta'ala will say, كُونُ تُرَابًا. Turn into dust. And all the animals will turn into dust. On that day of Qiyamah, when the kafir, When he sees that sight, he's going to say, Ya laytani kuntu turaba. On the day of Qiyamah, when he sees how the animals turn into dust, he's going to say, Ya Allah, can't you turn me into dust as well like the animals? But no. No, he has a punishment that is awaiting him. He has Jahannam that is awaiting him. He has the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is awaiting him. So he is worse in condition and in status than an animal. May Allah save us. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues the verse, and Allah ta'ala says, after you know what happened now between Nabi Adam alayhi salam and between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the malaika, and then between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Iblis, that whole story, you are able to complete the puzzle. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, look at how Iblis went on. Look at how he rejected. Look at how he went against my orders. أَفَتَتَّخِذُونَهُ وَذُرِّيَّتَهُ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِن دُونِي. Do you take him and his offspring, referring to Iblis and his offspring, as friends and allies, a part of me? And you do not take Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as your ally? Whilst in the first place, he's the enemy of Allah. He's the enemy of Rasulullah. He's the enemy of the Salihin. He's the enemy of all the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After he's disobeyed the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's the enemy since the beginning. He's the enemy of myself and of yourself. He's been the enemy since the beginning. How's that? When Allah ta'ala instructed him to make sujood to our father, Nabi Adam alayhi salam, what did he say? I'm not going to make sujood to him. Openly he declared his animosity to Nabi Adam alayhi salam. Your father, he declared animosity to. So he's been our enemy. Since inception of Nabi Adam alayhi salam, he's been the enemy. أَفَتَتَّخِذُونَهُ وَذُرِّيَّتَهُ أَوْلِيَاءَ. He's declared animosity and anger and dispute against and dissatisfaction against Nabi Adam alayhi salam, your father. Now you down the line, you want to come and you want to regard him as a friend. How does that work? How do you take him as a friend? And then you do not only take him as a friend, but you take him as a friend beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Man Allah subhanahu min dunillah. Besides Allah. Who's Allah? Ar-Ra'uf Ar-Rahim. The most merciful. Ghaffar al-Dhunub, the one who forgives our sins. Alladhi yubaddilu sayyi'at ila hasanat. The one who turns your evil deeds and bad deeds into good deeds. The one who has created you with his very own power and hands. Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, the one who's created the Jannah as a reward for me and for you. You take Iblis as a friend besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are exchanging and you're replacing Allah with Iblis. How does that fit? How does that work? La yastaqimu hadha. This cannot be correct. Who is the one who created me and you? Who is the one who placed that seed or that sperm, that drop of sperm into the womb of your mother? And then who is the one who developed that drop of sperm into a clot of blood that was attached to the womb? And then who developed that clot of blood into a alaqa, into a piece of meat that looks like a piece of chewed meat? And then who is the one who converted that alaqa into bones? And then who is the one that converted that bones and placed, beautified it with meat covering that bones? And who is the one who formed your body completely? And who is the one who blew and breathed into you from his soul? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَفَتَتَّخِذُونَهُ وَذُرِّيَّتَهُ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِن دُونِي. Do you take him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do you take Iblis alayhi salam as a friend besides Allah? After all that Allah ta'ala has done for you, you attached and you linked to your mother with an umbilical cord that causes you to be nurtured, that Allah ta'ala causes food and certain nutrients to come through there to feed you, so you can nurture, you can be nurtured from that, and so you can feed on that. And who is the person that came up with that method of feeding? Is it the professor? Or is it the doctor? Or is it the scientist? Who came up with it? رب العزة والجلال, ربي وربك, my lord and your lord, my overseer and my caretaker, and your overseer and your caretaker, my creator and your creator. He took care of all of that. And when you came out, you were able to see and you were able to hear and you were able to speak. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you leave all of this for who? Adu, enemy, adu, an enemy. Not only an enemy of you, an enemy of Allah. You leave it. And you replace your desires. You leave Allah Ta'ala's desires and you bring the desires of shaitan. You leave Allah Ta'ala's orders and you put in front the orders of shaitan. You put behind Allah Ta'ala's instructions and you put in front the instructions of shaitan. بِئْسَ لِلظَّالِمِينَ بَدَلًا. Allah Ta'ala ends of this ayah and Allah Ta'ala says, what an evil exchange is it that people have made. What an evil exchange is it for a wrongdoer to replace Iblis, to replace him with Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. La ilaha illallah. So, from this verse, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala then tells us, and Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala instructs us, that remember that your wali, your allies, your friends is Allah wa Rasuluh wa alladhina amanu. Innama waliyukum Allah wa Rasuluh wa alladhina amanu. Innama waliyukum Allah wa Rasuluh wa alladhina amanu. Do you hear Iblis in the equation? Innama waliyukum Allah wa Rasuluh wa alladhina amanu. Those who regard those three, Allah, His Messenger, and the believers as His friends and His allies, He is going to be successful and He is going to be أُولَٰئِكَ حِزْبُ اللَّهِ. They are indeed the party of Allah. أَلَا إِنَّ حِزْبَ اللَّهِ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. The party of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ever be successful, will ever be victorious. And those who do not associate themselves with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the believers, the salihin of the believers, if you disassociate yourself from them and instead you replace them and you exchange them, wal-iyadu billah, with Iblis, the enemy of Allah, the enemy of Rasulullah, and the enemy of the believers, then you form part of the Hizb al-Shaytan, the party of the Shaytan, the allies of the Shaytan. And what is the end abode of Hizb al-Shaytan? Ala inna Hizb al-Shaytan humul khasirun. Indeed, the allies of Shaytan are the losers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our eyes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us to realize that the only allies on this dunya is Allah. The only ally on this dunya is Rasulullah. The only ally on this dunya is Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and those who follow in the same steps and in the same suit of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. May Allah ta'ala allow us to take him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as an example. For he is our door to Allah. He is our key to Jannah. He is our savior on the day of Qiyamah. He is our guide on the path on this dunya. And was it not for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we would not have met here tonight. I would have not known Buta Ihsan and Buta Hassan and Buta Muhammad and Buta Is. I would have not known all these people. You would have not known me. You would have not known each other. But we are only sitting in a gathering of knowledge as a result of the sacrifice of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's the one who sacrificed. And then he's the one who brought us the knowledge. And through his sacrifice and his knowledge, we are able to sit here today. And we are able to benefit from his knowledge. And was it not for his knowledge, we would have not been sitting here. One would have been in the east, and other would have been in the west. One would have been, Allah Ta'ala alone knows where we have been. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala link us to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and join us to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in such a manner, in a join and in a link and in a knot that will never ever dissolve. That will never ever break. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Rabtan la yanhallu abada. A knot and a chain and a link that will never ever break or dissolve. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Subhanallah wa bihamdi. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.